looking at things differently. And the presentation that I'm going to give to you is from the guy that came up with that great idea. So Kevin, next slide, please. The first thing I want you to do is take a look at this definition. And this is the definition of a Ponzi scheme. And if you're not familiar with the Ponzi scheme, just read through this. I'm not gonna dwell on this, but I want you to read through it. And after I'm done, I'm going to put this definition back up, and I'll let you be the judge of sort of the conclusion that you draw yourselves. I'm not going to ask you to draw a conclusion. Next. Just a brief history of the public employee retirement system. It began in 1945. There is tier one, tier two, and now we have tier three developed over those years. It was never meant to be a full-time retirement. It was supposed to be a supplemental retirement. Back in 1945 when it started, if you fast forward to today's dollars, the average benefit was around $1,200 a month, which is a nice benefit, right? But it's not something that you're going to retire on. As a matter of fact, one of the fundamental tenets of this is that you also get Social Security. And that's a little bit unusual. Many states that have a retirement plan like this, you've opted out of getting the federal Social Security. As we dig into this, how many of you, think about this, how many of you are either going to or receive PERS or will receive PERS in some way, shape, or form, have children that will, or parents that will, or brothers and sisters that will or do? Raise your hand. Yeah, look around. About 350,000 people in the state either currently receive it or will receive it. Now, if you think about extended families of that, you get up to well over 1 million people are directly affected by this. Incidentally, it takes about 1 million votes to win statewide. So there's a very, very strong correlation, and this cuts across Republicans, Democrats, and Independents. There's a very strong correlation between solving the PERS problem and actually being able to garner enough votes to win statewide. Okay. Next up. The crux of a PERS system, public employee retirement system in Oregon, is what's called a defined benefit, meaning the state of Oregon promises to pay you a certain percentage of your salary at the time that you retire, as compared to what's called a defined contribution plan, like a 401k, where somebody gives you a certain amount of money, you might match it with some of your dollars, but the liability is over at the time that you receive it. So if I have a 401k, my company puts in some money, I match it with some money, done, right? A defined benefit is, at some point in the future, when you retire, we're gonna base some future benefit on whatever amount of money you're making at that some future point in time as a percentage of what you're making. So it's not something that you can quantify exactly today. You have to do an analysis, an actuarial analysis, an analysis of what this could possibly be in the future at this point in time. Now, you hear about these tiers, tier one and tier two, tier three, also called OPSERV. So tier one and tier two, it's 1.67 times your years of service, 1.67% times your years of service for general service, 2% times your years of service for police and fire. Tier three, one of the things you'll hear from the Democrats is, oh, tier three solved everything, right? It didn't solve everything. Tier three is only about 10% less than what tier one and tier two were in terms of the defined benefit portion. 1.5% times your number of years of service, about 45%, 1.8 times for police and fire. So the crux of this is it's a defined benefit plan. Next, Governor. On top of that, you have an individual retirement account where they put 6% aside for you, usually paid by the employer, not in every case, and then you have Social Security on top of that. All of these components go into your retirement plan. Can I have the next slide, please? So when I was running for office, I started running for treasurer, and treasurer really needs to understand this. If you're going to be the treasurer, I think you should understand this. It's the biggest responsibility you have. And I had the pleasure and ability to meet with the head of the PERS board, the head of the Oregon Investment Council. Many of my friends were on the Oregon Investment Council. In fact, Governor Kulongoski, a Democrat, actually worked with me to nominate some people to the Oregon Investment Council when I worked in that office. So if people ask me what effect did you have as a Republican working in a Democratic office, I'll tell you, there's a couple of people on the Investment Council that we got nominated. I also got to meet with the actuary. This is the group that actually figures out what this liability is going to be at some point in the future. It's not a group that many people get to meet with. They're very, very smart people. It's a private sector group. They get paid a lot of money to do this. And they actually do a very, very good job, but it's very arcane actuarial calculations that they do. So you hear all these numbers, 80 billion liability, 50 billion assets, 80-year lifespan, 10 billion payroll, 4.5 billion in payments, and let me stop at just those last two. You don't hear these numbers very often. The annual payroll of everybody that's eligible for PERS right now, so every teacher, all the state employees, some of your county government people, all of the people, the annual payroll is $10 billion a year. To put it in perspective, I think that's four times the payroll of Intel, the largest private sector employer in the state. That's how big this is. It's about 150,000 people, if you can imagine that. Now, the next one, $4.5 billion in payments to existing retirees. That means this year, it's actually a little higher than that this year, we'll write checks of $4.5 billion to the existing retirees. Well, wait a minute, even I can do this now. That's 45% of payroll is already being paid to the existing retirees right now, today. Now, you've probably never heard that number before. Why? Because it's scary, right? But it's absolutely, positively true. 45% today. Now, the reason you never hear that number is they've got some money saved and they move the money around and you'll hear 19%, 22%, 31%, 18%. You'll hear all those numbers, but it all gets back to $10 billion in payroll, $4.5 billion in checks, 45% of payroll already is being spent to cover them. Okay, next. You'll also hear that Illinois, oh my God, thank goodness we're not Illinois. Well, guess what? This is the 2015 liability, the population of each state, and then the liability per capita. How much of this liability are each of you responsible for? Well, lo and behold, each of you, your children, your parents, every individual, not family, every individual in the state, in Oregon, is liable for over $17,000. Where's Illinois? Oh, it's down there at $15,000. We're already worse than Illinois. In fact, we're way worse than Illinois already. Now, you'll never hear that, because that's the other thing that you'll hear, that people say, oh, thank goodness we're not Illinois. The guys in Illinois are saying, oh, thank goodness we're not Oregon. Next bill. And if you fast forward, just 1 year later, this is the 2016 numbers updated for Oregon. I didn't have the numbers for everybody else. We're rising the charts. We're all the way up to 3, right? Wouldn't it be great if we were 3rd in graduation rate?
Yeah.
19,000, almost $20,000 per person is the actuarial liability, and you're going to start to hear me use that term. That's your actuarial liability. That's not how much cash you owe. That's some funny calculation. We're going to get into that in a second. Next step. So, after digging around, I actually created this chart on my own from scratch, given the public information. And then I found the real chart. This is now the real chart. It's not my numbers, but my numbers correlated perfectly, meaning they were exactly the same as this chart. So this chart comes from Milliman. Milliman is the actuary. And this is the chart of the checks that we have to write for the next 30 years to cover the liability. So in this year, you can see it's now at about $4.7 billion. That's that first column. And it rises to over $8 billion, and then it starts to tail off. So one thing that people say is, oh, well, it tails off. We're done. We win. No problem. One of the assumptions of this chart is that we never hire another person.
I like that idea.
You never hire another teacher. You never hire another state employee. Nobody ever gets hired. Meaning, 30 years from now, does your pension liability roll off? Sure. Why? You never hired anyone. All that's happening is people are dying and retiring. That's it, right? But this is the right way. There's no phony baloney math going on here. This is the right way to calculate the actuarial liability. So I got this chart, and you look at those bars, and I said, oh, the actuarial liability is $78.3 billion, 350,000 people covered. And I looked at the bars, and I went, okay, that's $8 billion. So I go, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, wait a minute. That's $80 billion. That's $160 billion. Why is it that if I add up the bars, it doesn't equal the liability? Right? Didn't make any sense. Well, when you total the bars, it's $218 billion in cash. If you total the bars, it's $218 billion in cash. It's not $78.3 billion, which is the actuarial liability. The checks that you have to write are $218 billion. Now, the reason I got curious about this is because as governor, you don't really care what some goofy actuary says. It's like, tell me what I have to write in checks this year, and next year, and the next year, and the next year, and where's that money going to come from? How much comes out of savings? How much comes out of appreciation of the stocks and bonds that we hold? And how much do I have to take from the taxpayers to meet that obligation? I don't care what the actuarial liability is. Okay. The difference is the actuarial liability assumes that we're going to make 7.2% on our money every single year for the next 30 years. So if you, what's called discounting, you apply 7.2% discounting back every year. So that last bar is about $7.5 billion. It's $7.5 billion minus discounted at 7.2% for 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, 6 years, 7 years, all the way back to today. So Kev, next chart. So another thing that people talk about is, well, what if we assumed that we're not going to get 7.2%? What if we assume that we're going to get 5%? Your actuarial liability grows to almost $100 billion. Everybody's freaking out. The cash flow stays the same. The cash that's required stays exactly the same. And that's very important. So the message, if you don't take anything else out of this, it's like, look, we want to focus on this $218 billion cash liability. That actuarial calculation, that's fine for somebody doing actuarial stuff and bond rating and all kinds of other garbage. But it's garbage. You taxpayers got to come up with $218 billion freaking dollars over the next 30 years to cover this liability. Okay, Kev, next. This is what that liability looks like if you discount at 7.2%. Remember that big $7.5 billion bar on the far right? Well, you take that bar and you discount it back at 7.2%, it becomes, I don't know, $800 million. Not even worth worrying about. Right? So if you total up these bars, if you add up all these bars, that's where you get the $78.3 billion. And that's what that liability, go back to the previous slide, Kevin, that $218 million liability, that one, go to the next one, to the government, what we have on our books is this. That's what they think it is, right? Not from a cash standpoint. Okay, Kev, next slide. So, to put this in perspective, I gave this presentation down in Roseburg, and I found a house in Roseburg, $400,000. I said, what if I put zero down, got 4% fixed on a 30-year loan? Next, Kev. This is what that liability looks like. And you've all seen this. I have 30 years of principal that I pay off. That's going to be the $400,000. I have $287,000 of interest that I'm going to pay off, right? Y'all have, many of you have home loans, right? And when you sign your home loan, there's page after page after page saying, Alan, you do realize that you actually owe $687,487, not $400,000. You actually understand that, right? Right. You know all these disclosure things about interest, 280, right? All that stuff. So, if we use government math and take this liability of $687,000, Kev, next slide. This is what it looks like. It actually works out to be $281,000, right? So I want you to go walk into your bank and say, hey, I got some good news. I don't owe $687,000. I only owe $281,000. Another way to look at it would be, do you think the bank would let you just pay them $281,000 and give you the house? Because that's the way this math works. If I believe the 7.2% compounded, I should be willing to make that trade. I should be willing to accept $281,000 for that house. And that's just not true, right? It's just not true. So when they say $78 billion, they're doing the math this way. It's $218 billion. It's $218 billion. Okay, Kev, next. Now, they only go out 30 years. There's a lot of retirees that are still alive after 30 years. The average lifespan is 81 years. You know what the 1% number is? When 1% of the retirees are still alive? 101. 101. And they're getting their defined benefit inflated at 2% per year, because you got a cost of living increase, 2% per year, every year. And it's worse, because if you die and you have a spouse, and the spouse gets it. This is just assuming one. I haven't even gotten into the math of assuming you're passing it on to your spouse. So now, this is following all the way out till they all die. Now it's $352 billion. And I haven't hired anybody yet. So Kev, if you go to the next one, if you hire some people, now it's $607 billion, or 0.6 trillion. There's not enough gross domestic product in this state to satisfy this liability. It's not possible, right? In fact, if we were a corporation, if you're on the board of directors of a corporation, your duty shifts from shareholders to debtors when you get in this zone of insolvency. I'll tell you, we're in the zone of insolvency. If this was a company, we would have to start acting differently than we're doing right now. That little dip That little dip that you see there, that's the 10% difference between tier one, tier two, and tier three. It is a difference, right? It flattened a little bit for about 13 years, which is the time period between the two. Take that next. Now, another myth, tier three fixed the problem. So I'm just gonna go through some numbers. This is somebody that hires in at 21 years old, $15 an hour, at the very low end of the pay scale, the new minimum wage. No vacation accrual, 2% annual increase. They're going to rise from about 30-some thousand dollars a year to 50-some thousand dollars a year by the time they retire at 51 years old. Next step. So, the first layer is their defined benefit. And this is till they actuarially will die at 81 years old. And just that piece is $104 million. They earned 1.4 million dollars, $1.04 million. They earned $1.3 million during the time that they worked. But wait, there's more. Cash next. So now you have the individual account. On top of that, remember the 6% that was put aside, and that compounded over all those years. And I think I only compounded it at 6%. I didn't use the 7.2%. That's another $500,000. And Kev, the next one, you put $500,000 of Social Security on top of that. And next, you get a total of $2 million in retirement benefits. That's pretty good when you only earn $1.3 million your entire career. And you're a minimum wage worker. That's the minimum minimum, right? This is as low as it can get, right? And you retired at 51 years old. So it's a great program. In fact, most people, when I give this presentation, the one thing that they say is, I really screwed up that I didn't come work for the state 30 years ago, right? Everybody thinks that. So amazingly enough, a minimum wage worker hiring in today is a multi-millionaire in retirement. $2 million in retirement. Okay, next tip. So let's go back to our chart. What on earth is this solution? Because I never, one of my favorite bosses says, don't come to me with a problem unless you have some ideas about solutions. So the solution is pretty straightforward. Next slide, Kev. Is you go to a 401k. And this eliminates this weird actuarial liability that just kind of spins out of control. Because with a 401k, the state or your employer puts some money in, you put some money in, liability's over, done. There's an account, it grows, when you retire, they go, I get the money, or I take some kind of annuity based on that. It's very straightforward. It's very straightforward. It caps, and the other thing is you cap the existing program. So my solution that I've talked about is everybody that hired in up till today get exactly what you were promised, including Mike Bilotti's $500,000 a year, and including the recent retirees from OHSU that are going to be pulling down $800,000 or $900,000 a year. Wow. They made really good economic decisions back in the 1980s. Okay. But you cap all that, somebody hires in tomorrow, they go on 401k. And this actually can solve the problem. Now, it's not going to be easy. What all of this explains is why can we increase the school budget by 20% over the last 4 years and nothing happens? This is why, right? This is exactly why. Why does the Department of Transportation, we raise gas tax two or three times in the last decade and nothing happens? This is why. We're paying off this. Why do you have measure 97? Why do you have measure 66 and 67? You know, then they talk about all this stuff. All it's going to do is fund this. That's it. Okay, next, Kevin. So people ask me, okay, what happens if we just took our hands off the controls and let her run, we'll run out of money in 2030, about, if you don't pour more coal on. Even if you go, even if you cap the existing system. Then next. If you cap the existing system and you add a mere $1.25 billion a year, which sounds like an insane amount of money, but it's less than what we're doing right now, you start to lose money, your balance goes down, but then in about 2055 or so, you finally turn the corner, and you can decide to keep pouring money in or just stop at that point, because it's fully funded and everybody's paid off. So it's possible to do it. And my message when I debate Democrats about this is, just be honest, right? Just put the numbers up there and say to the citizens of Oregon, we need 25%, maybe 30% more in income tax to pay for this. And please vote for me, and when you do that, no, really. And please vote for me, because this is really an important thing for Oregon, and we just need to do this. That's what they're saying. They won't tell you that, but that's what they're really saying. Next step. So the conclusions here, it's the cash flow. It's not the actuarial liability. It's the $218 billion in cash flow. It's not the $78 billion in actuarial liability. And then we'll put up the last slide. It was the, that one. The only way this works is you gotta hire a whole bunch of people, right? You need the employment base to make the amount that you're paying to the retirees appear to be small. It fits this, I think, rather well. And it's been going on for 30 or 40 years. And as Republicans, I think this is the thing that we can go and say to the citizens of Oregon, if you elect us, we fix this. If you elect them, they don't. And they never will. They can't. It's too core to the reason that that party exists and how it's funded. They can't fix it, but we can. Thank you. Signing a new contract unless it is a defined contribution contract. A Republican governor could do that. Now, okay, what would happen? Well, Salem would be burned to the ground. Literally, it would be Scott Walker 2.0. There'd be a recall vote, right? You're being mean to teachers, school teachers. You're being mean to prison guards. You're being mean to all of the most sympathetic groups out there. But let's say you could endure that, right? Let's say you could endure that. And then you sign a contract that says we're now on a defined contribution. If you don't change anything else, as soon as there's a Democratic governor, they flip right back to a defined benefit plan. There's no legal binding, never turn back kind of thing, other than it's the right fiscal thing to do. TriMet, incidentally, switched. TriMet now is on a defined contribution plan, and it's working out, and they're working through the liability. But that's the problem politically. Unless we can come up with some other structure that prevents you from creating one of these plans.
So just as a follow-up, hypothetically, if we were to shift some existing state employees to the private employment sector, for example, if private schooling was more of an option, and we therefore would require the same number of teachers probably statewide, but only a portion of them in the public sector, and there would be more private sector teachers. If we were able to reduce the size of the public employee contingent, how much would that help the problem?
It helps, absolutely.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Quick question. What external forces from federal influence play a role in this? And if we were to distance ourselves from, you know, the federal slavery, if you will, financial slavery, would that help the situation? Is there anything our legislature could do, bills they could pass or whatever, to put ourselves away from that influence? Would that affect it?
To move away from federal influence?
Yeah, have less federal influence in it.
Remarkably enough, there might be part of the solution, maybe a federal solution, not a state solution, because you're never going to get it done in the state, right? You might get something done federally that would then apply to all, because we're not alone. Illinois is bad. They're not as bad as we are, but. Okay, quick.
Last one. Yeah, pretty simple question. So assuming that we can get all these changes done, assuming that a Republican governor makes this change, assuming that everything goes well, what impediment do the courts have? Because my understanding is the last time we tried to do diversion reform, the courts rejected it, and there's a little bit of a conflict of interest because they also received first.
Sure.
So how do you get around that?
What the court said is you can't do anything unilaterally retrospectively. So I can't unilaterally change the benefits of somebody that already has them. If you negotiated with them and they agreed to a reduction in benefits, no problem. The court said that's okay. They'll never do that. I wouldn't do it, right? Prospectively, going forward, you can do anything you want, and that's okay. You can't change what the existing people have, but if you hire somebody in new today, you could have no retirement benefits for them. You absolutely could do that. And that's why I focused on, look, freeze the existing system, quantify the liability. It's horrible, it's brutal. There's a lot of things in the state that aren't going to get done because we've committed to these retirement benefits. Let's admit that. But going forward, let's not keep making the same mistake. Thank
you. It's a complex process, but it can be done. But you literally have to take at a starting point. You have to implement the change process. You can't go back and undo what's already been done. That's there. You're going to be stuck with it. But you can't set it up going forward. The biggest contractual obstacles or legal obstacles we saw were the contracts that we had with the unions. By the way, I had 11 different union groups that we had to go forward with on this. And it does take leadership to step up and say, I'm just not going to agree with that, to take the heat, to go through the process. It's probably going to be a one-term governorship if they do it, because I'm not sure you can survive it. In the private sector, you're somewhat buffered by your board of directors, and your board of directors have a duty, which you would hope our legislature would have a duty to do, to make sure that the organization survives, and that it's okay. But those projections in the private sector, as you well know, they're not sustainable. There's not enough money in the world to do it. So at some point, you just have to take the hit and go forward with it.